We're in the last chapter of 2 Kings. We started the Chronicle of the Kings all the way back in January of 2015. So it's been 2 years and 9 months. It's been a while. But you know what? So much of important history for the nation of Israel, because in the 11th chapter of the 1 Kings book, we saw the nation of Israel split in two because of the greed and the pagan attitude of King Solomon. When the nation was split in two, it became a faction that at times produced civil war, but in the end, northern Israel was lost because of their pagan attitudes, and Assyria took most of them, killed many of them, leaving Judah to the south, which encompassed only two of the tribes, Judah and Benjamin, in the city of Jerusalem. To the south of Jerusalem, that was referred mostly as Judah, and pretty soon, as the Assyrians had overcome Judah, they stood outside the walls of Jerusalem. As Rabshakeh, the butler of Sennacherib of the Assyrians, cursed across the wall and called Hezekiah a liar and pled with the people of Jerusalem, come out, we will merely make slaves of you. And that's quite an extension, because the Assyrians typically took no prisoners. And when they did, they only took the young women. But as Rabshakeh curses across the wall and calls God a liar and calls Hezekiah a liar, soon Hezekiah, under the prophecy of Isaiah, would recognize that God has a plan for Jerusalem. He has a plan for his people. If they will obey his word, if they will trust in him. And friends, it's difficult when the enemy is outside your wall. It really is. I understand the great struggle of humankind, the frailty of our faith, to trust in God when things come across the wall that really cause you to struggle with the anchor of our soul in Jesus. And this morning, as we look at now the concluding verses of a chronicle of the nation of Israel and Judah coming to its close, and now Judah has been carried away, Jerusalem is left, and now as Hezekiah let the ambassadors of the Chaldeans a few years earlier walk through the temple and walk through the great treasuries of the city of Jerusalem, they've come back now to get those at the expense of the city of Jerusalem. And God has forewarned them of the great woes that will fall upon the city, describing the eventual ruin of Jerusalem like a woman wiping a plate clean. Here, the city of Babylon and its king Nebuchadnezzar has come. And he has come really not necessarily to take prisoners, though we know now as we begin chapter 25 that Jeremiah is in his 23rd year of prophecy in the streets of Jerusalem. The walls are being broken down. The Chaldeans are rushing in. They are killing everyone in sight. They are taking the few beyond those they have already taken, like Daniel. Daniel is now several years into his occupancy in Babylon. At the age of 12 or 13, he has been castrated to live among the eunuchs, who would be special young men who would serve in the court of the king in the presence of the harem of Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar, of course, wanted to make sure that no other man had the capacity to woo his harem away from him. So each of the young Hebrew boys, four are counted in Daniel chapter 1, are castrated and then taught the language of the Chaldeans and taught the ways and the culture, etc., of the Chaldeans. And then they, in essence, become Babylonians themselves as Nebuchadnezzar changes their name and insists that they will never be called by their Hebrew names again. Yet Daniel refers to himself as Daniel throughout his lifespan. Jeremiah has very keenly understood that because Jerusalem would not turn their hearts back toward home, not consider their sins as noteworthy or in need of being recompensed and confessed before God. They've sought other gods. They have sacrificed their children before these gods. And God says, I will not let their innocent blood go unpaid. Jeremiah, in Jeremiah chapter 25, the first 11 verses of there, brings the lament of God himself against the city of Jerusalem. This was not God's plan. It was man's plan to walk away from God. It's intriguing to me that those that have truly tasted of the glorious gift of Christ, the blessing of his presence and his Holy Spirit, would turn aside and walk back after the vomit that they threw up one day earlier in their life. Go back to insanities. Go back to torments. It's beyond description. But here Jeremiah calls out God's lament in verse 1 of chapter 25. He says, the word that came to Jeremiah concerning all the people of Judah in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, which was the first year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. By the way, this is also the year that Daniel begins his prophecies in Babylon. Here Jeremiah the prophet spoke to all the people of Judah and to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, verse 3, from the 13th year of Josiah, the king of the son of Ammon, king of Judah, even to this day, this is the 23rd year I have been standing in the streets and no one is listening. No one is listening. And I have spoken to you, rising early and speaking, but you have not listened. This is the Lord that's saying this. You haven't listened to my prophet Jeremiah. And the Lord has sent to you all his servants and prophets, rising early and sending them, but you have not listened nor inclined your ear to them. And they said, here's what they were preaching, repent now for every one of his evil way and his evil doings, and dwell in the land that the Lord has given to you and your fathers forever and ever. Stop going after other gods to serve them and worship them. Do not provoke me in anger with the works of your hands, and I will not harm you. Yet you refuse to listen to me, says the Lord, that you might provoke me to anger with the works of your hands to your own hurt. Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, because you have not heard my words. Behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, says the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, who is my servant, will bring against them and against this land, against its inheritance, and against these nations all around. He will utterly destroy them and make them an astonishment, a hissing, and a perpetual desolation. Moreover, I will take them from the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, the voice of the bride, the sound of the millstones and the light of the lamp. This whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. It strikes me, I think in terms of what the Lord says, Jesus speaking to John in the revelation of Jesus Christ, he is accounting to John the things that will happen. I believe in the future, certainly, but also very near, that as each of the seals are broken, as each of the bowls are poured, as each of the woes and the trumpets are sounded, men refuse to listen. They just simply won't listen to the word of God. Revelation 11 describes two witnesses who are empowered by the Holy Ghost to preach in the streets of Jerusalem, and they will not listen. In fact, they kill them both, only to see them stand in their death and rise into heaven. But telling above all these events in Revelation chapter 9, John sees these creatures coming up out of the earth. They're unique creatures, taxonomous don't know how to account the description in Revelation to anything that currently lives, that lives in the animal kingdom. These are flying scorpions that have armor on them. They're incapable of being killed. But beyond that, they are capable and go about stinging those with the mark of the beast upon them. And the stings don't kill people. It just terrorizes them over and over and over. In the close of chapter 9, it's astonishing to me. At the close of chapter 9, it says, "But the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of the works of their hands, that they should not worship demons, idols of gold, silver, brass, stone, and wood, which can neither see nor walk nor hear, and they did not repent of their murders or their sorceries or their sexual immorality." They would not repent. It's striking to me. It really is. That people will live through storms and catastrophes and pestilence and honestly, kind of the events that are happening in Florida. I would think that the state of Florida would be on their faces before God and pleading for God's blessing, their repentance, their confession before the living God. I really do believe, dear friends, congregation, that's what you would be doing if you lived in Florida. Now another hurricane, perhaps the same strength as Irma, is following the same path. What does it take, friends? This is my cry out to you. I was reading on an internet site how 23 things have happened so far, just in the first half of the month of September, that are unlike things that have ever happened in human history previous, or at least in recorded history. Meteorologically, and the CDC is talking about diseases that are now rampant in Florida that have been missing for years. Mosquitoes that are basically taking over the state and passing West Nile virus and even malaria. That's insane. Malaria hasn't been in America for decades. And yet these things, it's happening in our day. And you would think, wouldn't you think, that people would fall on their face and cry out to the living God for help? I haven't heard of that happening. I suppose there are remnants, there are pockets of people doing that. Jeremiah said to Jerusalem, 70 years have been decreed. Seems like a random number, though 70 is often mentioned in Scripture. But it's also intriguing to me that there is a unique connection that comes in Jeremiah 34 with respect to events that have happened over 490 years. Now, why doesn't Jeremiah say that? Because it was expected among Israelis, among the Jews, to understand that every 7 years, like every 7 days, there is a Sabbath. Every 7 years, there's a sabbatical year. In that sabbatical year, on the seventh year, all the things that you stored up in the first 6 years would be used for your sustenance in the seventh year, much like the seventh day, Shabbat, you eat the things that you've stored up in the previous 6 days. On the sabbatical year, your Hebrew brothers are to be released from slavery, from their debts. They are to be forgiven their sins. Their land is to stay fallow for that year, to rest, because it's a year of rest. It's a year for the nation to remember that God has forgiven them and that as God rested, so also should they rest. But they refuse to. Why? Greed and avarice. I can't afford to let people free from their debts. It's that kind of sense about them. And an interesting thing is that God keeps perfect records. God keeps perfect records of our sin until we meet Jesus. Now, that's an important fork in the road. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 describes the substance of love. Love keeps no record of wrongdoing. Neither does God in his love. And God desires that none would perish. But friends, without the blood of Jesus, your sins look like a gaping ulcer before God. He sees nothing but your sins and remembers nothing but the record of your sins until you meet Jesus, until the blood of Christ washes you of all wrongdoing, until you're released from the captivity of sin, from the yoke and the bondage of sin. You can't do it yourself. There is nothing that any psychologist, psychiatrist, any doctor, anybody else in this world can do to change your eternal state except the blood of Jesus. And until that point that the blood of Jesus is placed upon your sins, all the Father sees is your sin. That's all he can see. He sees your record of wrongdoing. But once you come to know Jesus as your Savior, once you bow your head at the cross and you cry out for a Savior to wash you, though your sins be as scarlet, his promise is your sins will be white as wool, whiter than snow. Your sins will be taken away completely. And in Jeremiah's day, the hope was that God would look past, would look over, would look around their sins. There was no eternal recompense until the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world gave his life on that cross, and his blood, the Passover blood of the Lamb of God, washed us all of our sin. And friends, listen. At the moment that you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, your record of wrongdoing is paid off completely. This is why Jesus on the cross was able to declare account paid in full. In many of your scriptures, it says tetelestai, which is a Greek word that says, bam, pound, account paid in full. It's like you get your mortgage in your hand and you get to burn it before God. I'm free! Whee! I doubt many of us have done that, but your account before God is abolished. Now, when the Father looks at his child, he sees the blood of Christ. He sees a forgiven child, a child of promise, a child of the King. And you know what? The record of wrongdoing is gone. Now, God keeps a different record. Did you know that he keeps a record of right doing from that point on? You can't do right without Jesus. Now you can do lots of right. And Paul, speaking to the church of Corinth, speaks about the bema, the judgment seat of Christ, where we will stand and not our salvation being judged as a, baptized, born-again believer in Jesus Christ, but rather our actions as a believer. And truthful, as Paul says, many of our actions outside of a motive to give God alone the glory will be burned up as wood, hay, and stubble. But the few things that we have done to the glory of Christ and have made very careful steps to give him all the glory. You know, it's often been said, and I love to repeat this, the secret of service is to serve in secret, to give God all the glory. Jesus says, if you want your reward on earth, you'll get it, but you won't get one in heaven. The wonderful thing is that in his record of right doing, one day you will stand before the King of God, King of heaven and earth. And he will reward you for what you have done in Christ's name by visiting those that are in prison, by attending to the sick, by being a servant as Jesus is a servant. Being the last among many means being first in heaven. The people of Judah have exchanged the truth for a lie. We see the world circling the toilet bowl because they have exchanged the truth of God's word for a lie. And how many lies? There are bazillions of them. And some of them are quite persuasive. Many of our college kids today is in universities of high learning where after graduating they have, $100,000 of student debt. They have unusable degrees in European literature or, you know, French art. What do you do with that? Well, you go to work at In-N-Out Burger. Oh, but I have a master's. Okay, well, you get to go to Jack in the Box. And they come out with aberrant ideas from these ungodly professors about who Jesus is. It is so popular today to be an atheist. And in some knuckleheads, they think, well, I'm agnostic. Oh, well, tell me, what does that mean? Not really sure, but that's what I am. And Jesus weeps over his children. I know that he does. Down from the Mount of Olives, when we visit Jerusalem, it's a wonderful place. So we begin the portion of our tour in Jerusalem by starting at the top of the Mount of Olives, and we begin to walk down the Palm Sunday road. We rehearse. We think in terms of what happened that Sunday. We think about what it must have been like for hundreds of thousands of Jews residing on the Mount of Olives for a good viewpoint of what's happening on the Temple Mount as Jesus and his disciples begin that dusty road down the hill. And about halfway down the hill is a cathedral that it's really a very beautiful cathedral, and it gives you a really great viewpoint of the Golden Gate, the Eastern Gate of the Temple Mount, in which Jesus one day will make his way through. And the name of the cathedral is Dominus Flevit, which means God cried. Because it's there that Jesus stopped as he's looking over the city, he's looking over the temple, he's looking over the house that his father would reside in. And he realized, my people have exchanged the truth for a lie. And as the Pharisees demanded that his disciples stop singing the Hosanna Psalms, he said, if they were to stop, even the rocks would cry out. Which means there are rocks that are smarter than some people. Jeremiah had this sense as God spoke to him, and he prescribed, as it were, 70 years of captivity. A year for each of the sabbatical years that they refused to take according to the law, and over 490 years of Israeli history, they had not taken one, so they owed God 70 years. So here's what God's saying. You will have rest in the prisons of Babylon, and you will give me those 70 years that you owe me, because your record of wrongdoing has brought you to a place where the only way I could minister to you is for you to have no other thought than what you were stolen away from. Do you have that sense at times? You need to have that sense at times. I know addictions today are so prevalent. Oh, I'm not addicted. Oh, really? Well, it's not heroin, or, you know, it's not methamphetamines. What could it be? Could it be pornography? Do you spend your entire year waiting for that one copy of Sports Illustrated to arrive at your front door? You can hide it from your wife in your garage and peruse all the sad, very sad little girls. You don't hear the feminists rising up in hatred for such things. You don't hear the feminists going against Spearmint Rhino. You don't hear the feminists marching against the nudie bars in Las Vegas. And you don't hear that because it's more noteworthy to march against our president, or to march against, as the There are pastors, there are prophets crying out in the streets of America to repent. And I had a great study last Sunday, and I didn't teach any of it. But what I did, I hope you secured in your heart that there is such a desperate need for us to repent before the Lord, to be the church of Jesus Christ, more so now than ever before, because this is the hour, this is the day, this is the time to be the salt and the light in this community. Turns out in verse 1, now it became to pass in the 9th year of his reign, in the 10th month, on the 10th day of the month, that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and all his army came against Jerusalem and encamped against it, and they built a siege wall against it all around, so that the city was besieged until the 11th year of King Zedekiah. Now, for 2 years, Nebuchadnezzar is beating down Jerusalem and, as prophesied, wipes it like a woman would wipe a plate. Many have already been taken to Babylon, including Daniel and Ezekiel. Many will be born in Babylon, like Zerubbabel and Ezra and Nehemiah. Men of God that God still has his hand upon that are called to preach to the nation of Israel that God is faithful to his promises. And when 70 years has passed, and we see the day that it begins. And it's interesting, when God speaks of a specific day, you know why? Because he wants you to draw a line in the timeline of history that something is happening here that will be attested to in the years to come. And when did the hourglass of 70 years get turned? On the 9th year, in the 10th month, on the 10th month, day of the year, of the month. It's interesting that it wasn't until the 24th chapter of Ezekiel's prophecy that Ezekiel speaks about that very day. When God wakens Ezekiel on that morning, in Ezekiel chapter 24, verse 1, again in the 9th year, in the 10th month, in the 10th day of the month, the word of the Lord came to me and said, "Son of man, write down the name of this day, for this is the very day that Nebuchadnezzar will wipe Jerusalem like a woman wipes a plate." Daniel, of course, in Daniel chapter 9, will think in terms of when will this 70 years be over. And he declares in Daniel chapter 9, starting in verse 1, that I read the scroll of Jeremiah, and Jeremiah said 70 years. And I'm saying to you, God, now, Daniel must have been about 82, 84. I'm saying to you, God, the time has been spent. And so God started the gears of sending through the Persians, the ambassadors of Nehemiah, Zerubbabel, and Ezra back to Jerusalem to rebuild the walls, to rebuild the temple, and to start, as it were, now the post-exilic church body of the nation of Israel once again. Jeremiah would later pen, near the close of his life, the 5 chapters of Lamentations. He's not only the author, we believe, of 1 and 2 Kings, but also the author of not only the prophecies of Jeremiah, but also the Lamentations of Jeremiah. And I'll just say this. It is interesting that Jeremiah was referred to as the weeping prophet because he wept before God almost constantly. And it was that in Matthew 16, when Jesus turns to his disciples, Caesarea Philippi. It's a wonderful place in Israel to stop on the Via Mar, the Highway 1 of the Romans, where Jesus stopped with his disciples, maybe 120 of them at that point. And he said, "Who do others say that I am?" What a question. It takes guts to ask that kind of question, I would say. Maybe to ask your friends, "What do you think of me?" Do you have the courage to ask that question? Jesus said, "What do others say that I am?" And the first answer was, "Some say that you're Jeremiah." Now, Jeremiah was known for his prophecies and his lamentations, really 5 chapters of weeping before God, lamenting, which means to weep bitterly before God. Five chapters of prose, of poetry, that would be sung out of the heart of Jeremiah, recognizing that Jerusalem was gone. City of his love, the temple of his adoration, gone. And he said, Jesus, some say you're Jeremiah. Could it be that Jesus was known for weeping as Jeremiah did? It's amazing. That's the first person. Others say, you're Jeremiah. How much does God weep over his people? I would venture to say much. Much. Jeremiah writes in Lamentations chapter 2, see, O Lord, and consider, to whom have you done this? In fact, should the women of Jerusalem be eating their offspring? The very children that they have cuddled? Should the priest and the prophet be slain in the sanctuary of the Lord? Young and old lie on the ground in the streets. My virgins and my young men have fallen by the sword. You have slain them in the day of your anger. You have slaughtered them and not pitied them. You have invited as to a feast day the terrors that surround me. In the day of God's anger, there was no refuge, no refugee or survivor. Those whom I have born and brought up, my enemies have destroyed. But it's intriguing to me that at the very midpoint of the five chapters of Lamentations, Jeremiah writes this. And it's so important. In the midst of our trials, in the midst of our enemies, in the midst of perhaps even having your plate wiped clean, that Jeremiah writes, this I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. Through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. But the Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. For it is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. I can imagine the people of Florida looking at their houses obliterated. Nothing left in Key West, in Puerto Rico. I wonder if that in their hearts they realize, I still have hope in Jesus. Is that where your heart would go if all that you owned was lost? The devastation of Texas, the devastation of Florida, we haven't lived through. We may have friends and family that are living through that right now. And we may, through the telephone lines or through emails or even instant messages, be encouraging them that there is a God whose faithfulness is new every single morning. And they may be thinking, well, easy for you to say, because you're not standing at the doorstep of your house that is totally gone. But it should be easy for us to say. It should be easy for them to say. It should be the first thought on their mind. I have a God who is faithful. I know, as Job said, in the midst of his devastation, my Redeemer lives. Does your Redeemer live in your life today? Irrespective of what you are facing this week, can you cry out to God, I know that you live. I know that your compassion fails not, and that every single morning, great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. This is where we should reside. This is what we should be known by. Friends, this is what our identity must be. We must be identified by a heart that does not fail, that clings to the rock of that solid rock, that clings to the anchor of Christ. This is who we are. This is who we should be known by. I don't know what's going to happen in America soon or in California. It has been intriguing to me that in the last 2 weeks, two rather large earthquakes have hit Maricopa. We have a 500-mile stretch of the San Andreas Fault that is very close to us and, of course, goes right through Northridge into Los Angeles. Are we looking at the earmarks of something that is going to be significant on the West Coast? We really can't expect hurricanes to hit us too significantly, but we do expect major earthquakes to settle this great pressure between the plates of the ring of fire, the Pacific. Are you ready? Are you ready to stand over the rubble of your house and say, "My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives"? Are you prepared to stand in Waller Park because every building in this community is gone, and with the other creatures of Christ cry out, "My Redeemer lives"? I know this, that His faithfulness is new every morning, every single morning. See, Jesus told us, in fact, He warned us, but also encouraged us, in this world you will have tribulation. And somehow in the midst of that tribulation, you're to have good cheer because He has overcome the world. This world is not our home. This city is not our home. My passport isn't one of heaven, but that's who I am. My heart is planted in the kingdom of heaven. And this I recall, there I have hope that His faithfulness is new every morning. Friends, as we go on and finish now, 2 Kings, keep in mind this. We're not going to see some couple riding on white horses into the sunset. It just gets worse. And it just gets worse. And as we close 2 Kings chapter 25, we open the book of Daniel as Daniel begins where 2 Kings 25 ends. So we'll be in Daniel chapter 1 next Sunday. But I want you to recognize this. What became of the Israelites was not because God wanted to do this. I want you to know, as Jeremiah said, God had to do it. And you know why He had to do it? Because He has a love for the Word of God that is above the love of your sin. And He desires none to perish. I believe the Holy Spirit is opening the streets of Santa Maria for the message of Christ like it's never been before. I believe the central coast of California is going to be the epicenter of hopefully a great revival before Jesus comes for His bride. I've got friends that don't know Jesus to save their soul, and I pray that they would. I pray desperately that they would. They won't listen to me, but maybe they'll listen to you. Maybe the Holy Spirit will draw them in a manner that may, in a divine appointment, cross your path. And just a few words, "Jesus loves you," might turn their hearts towards home. This is my prayer. And it turns out in verses 3 and 4 that by the ninth day, the famine became so severe that the city had no food for the people of the Lord, of the land. And the army of the Chaldeans, in verse 5, pursued the king, and they overtook him in the plains of Jericho, and his army was scattered from him. So they took the king and brought him up to the king of Babylon. Here's Nebuchadnezzar in a city just 20 or so miles away in Riblah, and they pronounced judgment upon him, and then they killed the sons of Zedekiah before Zedekiah's eyes. Imagine that. And then they put the eyes of Zedekiah, they scooped them out, and the method in those days was to put a spoon in the fire and then scoop the person's eyes out so it would cauterize the blood. They bound him with bronze fetters and took him to Babylon. Imagine that. And in the fifth month, in the seventh day of the month, which was the 19th year of the king of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, Nebuzaradan, the captain of Nebuchadnezzar's guard, a servant of the king of Babylon, he came to Jerusalem. It's pretty much the battle is over. There's only a few people remaining in Jerusalem. Some of them have defected to Nebuchadnezzar and are worshiping him now as their god. And there are others that are the poor and disinfected who are staying to dress the vines and to take care of the few fields that surround Jerusalem. But he comes and he burns down the house of the Lord, and then also the king's house, and all the houses of Jerusalem. That is, all the houses of the great he burned with fire. And all the army of the Chaldeans who were with the captain of the guard broke down the walls of Jerusalem, every portion of the wall. So when Nehemiah returns in about 80 years, Nehemiah will find, as his brothers report to him in Nehemiah chapter 1, there is not a rock upon another that a fox may hide himself. Well, how could this be? Because Jerusalem has been wiped as a woman would wipe a plate. And the captain of Nebuchadnezzar of the guard carried away the captives and the rest of the people, verse 11, who remained in the city, and the defectors who had deserted to the king of Babylon, and the rest of the multitude. And the captain of the guard left some of the poor of the land of the vine dressers as vine dressers and farmers. And then he begins to tear down the bronze pillars, all the bronze pieces from the temple itself. And the carts and the bronze seed that were in the house of the Lord, the Chaldeans broke them into pieces and carried their bronze to Babylon, as described in 1 Kings chapter 3 through 8. These are pieces that are tons in perfect bronze. And bronze was very valuable in those days, particularly the kind of bronze that would be in the temple, pure. They broke them apart and took them back to Babylon. The fire pans and the basins, the things of solid gold and solid silver. Well, the captain of the guard took those away personally. And the two pillars, one sea, and the carts that Solomon had made for the house of the Lord. The bronze of all these articles was beyond measure. And the height of one pillar was 27 feet. And the capital on it was of bronze. And the height of the capital alone was 4.5 feet. And the network and the pomegranates all around the capital were all of solid bronze. The second pillar was the same with a network. And the captain of the guard took Seraiah, the chief priest, Zephaniah, the second priest, and the three doorkeepers. That would be like the pastor and the associate pastor, Pat. And he took the doorkeepers, ushers, and deacons, and he took them out of the city. And an officer in charge of the men of war, 5 men of the king's close associates who were found in the city, the chief recruiting officer of the army who mustered the people of the land, and 60 men of the people of the land who were found in the city, Nebuzaradan, captain of the guard, took these and brought them to the king of Babylon at Riblah, and the king of Babylon killed them with his own sword. And so then Nebuchadnezzar makes Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, the governor over the people who remained in the land of Judah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had left. Now, when all the captains and the armies, they and their men, heard that the king of Babylon had made Gedaliah governor, they came to Gedaliah at Mizpah, Ishmael, the son of Nethaniah, Yohanan, the son of Kareah, Zeraiah, the son of Tanhumeth, the Netophathelite, say that a bunch of times, and Jaazaniah, the son of Maakathite. I'm afraid I'd change his name if he was my son. I would. And Gedaliah took an oath before them and their men and said to them, "Do not be afraid of the servants of the Chaldeans." Now, Gedaliah is the puppet governor that Nebuchadnezzar has put there. Listen, Nebuchadnezzar's a good guy. He won't treat you poorly. But we soon discovered that those that remain in Jerusalem through verse 26, they killed Gedaliah. Why? Because they're sick of Confederates. They're sick of people that turn against not only the people of Jerusalem, but from the Lord God himself. And it turns out in verse 27, that in the 37th year of the captivity of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, this is a postscript, as it were, by Jeremiah. This is the close of the testimony. That it happened on the 12th month, the 27th day of the month, that Evil, not evil, though he was evil, Merodach, king of Babylon, now he's taken over since Nebuchadnezzar, in the year that he began to reign, released Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from prison, spoke to him kindly, made him his friend. He got to eat with him the rest of his life. And in verse 30, as for his provisions, there was a regular ration given to him by the king, a portion for each day in all the days of his life. An interesting way for Jeremiah to close the testimony of the kings over all these chapters. As I said, it's not a happy ending, but here's what's going to happen. In the first five chapters of Daniel, we're going to see history turn on its edge as Nebuchadnezzar, full of himself, begins to be moved by the Spirit of God and by the testimony of Daniel, because he recognizes in Daniel that God speaks to this man in a way that none of his satraps, his shamans, his witch doctors, his wise guys, his astrologers can say. Daniel has the insight of God from God's lips to his ears. He hears what God says and he relates it to Nebuchadnezzar, and in the end, Nebuchadnezzar's heart is changed. I would say to you that at the close of Daniel chapter 4, we will see that Nebuchadnezzar is saved. That's my opinion. I believe when we get to heaven, you're going to meet Nebuchadnezzar, because his testimony with respect to the God of Israel is one that none of the Israelites had, save Ezekiel and Daniel, and perhaps Daniel's three other friends. Nebuchadnezzar witnesses things that few in life have ever witnessed. He sees the hand of God not only slay him mentally for 7 years to eat cud like a calf in the courtyard of the king's palace, but at the close of those 7 years, because of Nebuchadnezzar's greed and pride, Nebuchadnezzar comes back to his sanity and recognizes that the God of Israel, there is no God but Jehovah. Now, I know a lot of insane people, and I would say they're insane because they refuse to turn back to Jesus. That's insanity. And you know the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. But here's what the Lord says to you today. I can testify to you that the Lord God Almighty lives, and that he has a great love for you. And the issues of your life, the circumstances of your life, could be much like the history of Israel and Judah. But God is patient. You see that? God is faithful. He is waiting for you to come back and fall on your face and plead with God. Plead for the blood of Jesus to once again wash you of your wrongdoing. You may say to me, Paul, but there's so many things I do in my community. There's so many different fraternities and groups that, I mean, after all, I'm part of the, you know, Breakfast Rotary. I'm sorry to pick that out if you're in that. It's a good group. My point is, they can't save you. No matter what right doing you're doing, it can't save you. Only one man's right doing on the cross 2,000 years ago can change your eternity, and that's Jesus.